It is well with the soul. Amen?
Amen.
But the question is it truly well with your soul? Shall we bless the name of the Lord?
Amen.
See, when we sing, we must sing with the understanding. Even as we are on the land of the living, my people, we have an opportunity. Are you there with me this afternoon? No matter if you're rich, no matter if you're poor, no matter if they put you back to the soil, they put you in a tomb. From dust you were born, from dust you shall return. Are you like me? So whether you are rich, whether you are poor, when it comes to death, all of us will fit in a box. Are you like me? So may God bless you and keep you, and may God comfort the family. When as I invite Shanta to read our scripture reading for us from the book of Hebrews, chapter 9, verse 24 to 29. Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 9, sorry. Verse 24 to 27. Amen.
For Christ is not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Nor yet that he should offer himself often, as the high priest entereth into the holy place every year with the blood of others. For then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world. But now, once in the end of the world, have he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment, so Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Shall we bless the name of the Lord? Shall we say hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
I know, tell you something. We in the Western world, when people die, we are saddened. Amen. But let me tell you something. When you die, you have nothing on your account. Amen. You have nothing on your account. The most important thing is the life that you live before you die. Blessed be the name of the Lord. So that is an appointment you have every day. Are you there listening with me, for me, people? You walk with death every day. Death is with you. You don't know what day, what time. But my encouragement to you is make sure that you live a life that is pleasing and acceptable in the sight of God. That when death knock at your door, you will enter into the joy of the Lord. Amen? At this moment, I'll kindly ask you to stand with me while I call on Pastor Stephen. He's going to pray a prayer on the behalf of the family. Bless the name of the Lord. So I want to welcome Pastor Stephen and Pastor Lee, who is there with us in Jesus' name. So Pastor Stephen will pray a prayer of comfort. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Let's just bow in prayer. Oh, Father, we thank you for your loving kindness and your tender mercies. We thank you for your compassion and your grace. We thank you that we are here today as we mourn the loss of our dear brother. But we pray, Lord, that you would comfort his family, those who are here, his friends, his family, those who took care of him, those who watch over him. May you comfort them, I pray, Father. And I pray that, Lord, that even at this moment, that you would cause them to reflect and to know that one day they also too can see their brother again if they accept the Lord. So Father, I pray that you would comfort and guide and keep as we commit the family to you in Jesus' name.
Amen. Praise the Lord. So we're going to remain standing. We're going to sing our second song. As you know, time is against us. We had some little hiccups during the day. We have another funeral to happen in this place. So we're going to go for a program. I've wandered far away from God. Now I'm coming home. Very important song. of the Lord, you may be seated. At this moment, I'm going to invite Pastor Stephen to the sermon, praise the name of the Lord, to please relax and listen to the word of Almighty God. Amen.
Good afternoon, friends and colleagues, brethren. I greet you all in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, our King of Glory. I want to extend my condolences to the family and friends and loved ones of Mr. Peter Isaac, who came into this world, and the time came that he had to leave. And I pray that God grant you strength and consolation in this time of loss. Let's bow and pray. Father, we thank you for you understand our emotions and our feelings. Father, you understand our grief because you too had a son and he too, he died. So you understand, Father, what we have to endure. But we pray that you would comfort every heart. And most of all, may Peter's life and his death may mean something and may bring light to somebody. And let me fall in your hands in Jesus' name. Alright, today we have to be very on time. However, I'm going to try my best to be very short with you. It's not something I'm accustomed to, but I'll have to try to be very short, okay? Today, I want to speak to you generally. Now, I'm speaking to you and not to Peter, right? You can't hear me. Yes or no? You can't hear me. So, funerals are not for the person. Funerals is for you. Yes or no?
Yes.
You that are alive, that's who I'm speaking to, not Peter. Anything I have to say to Peter, I have to say to him before. Now he can. Even the eulogy that has been read or was read, he can't even say, I agree. He can't even say, that's not true. He can't even say, wow, you love me so much. He can't say nothing. Peter is gone. Peter has left the building. And not today. It's not today Peter has left. On October 10th, Peter left. His consciousness left. His soul left. All that has remained of him here is a body. A shell. That's all. And the reason why it has to go into the ground is because that is where it came from. But there was a part of him that did not come from the ground, and that was his soul. And that soul, the Bible says in the book of Ecclesiastes, it had to go back to the person who gave it to him. Every one of us sitting here, we have a soul. You don't see it, but it's your consciousness. It is what you interact with God with. It is where you experience emotions of hatred and love and envy and pride and jealousy and all these things that we go for. These intangible emotions that we experience, it is experienced in the soul. So no wonder Christ said, Christ told his disciples, do not fear the man who can destroy just your body, but fear the man who can destroy your body and soul and cast it into hell. Somebody will take a gun and shoot you, they'll just destroy your body, that's all you do. But they can't touch your soul. A bullet cannot touch your soul. But there's a fire that's coming. And that was created for souls. Now, today what I will speak to you very quickly about is the appointment. There is an appointment that every single one of us have. Rich, poor, educated, uneducated, white, black, Chinese, Japanese, whatever you call yourself. There is an appointment. And guess what? That appointment, nobody can miss it or even reschedule it. Nobody will say, I'm not ready yet. Come back tomorrow.
Or, you know, give me a few more days. Even if you late for the appointment, that appointment will not be late for you.
Yes. Yes.
It's not you that keeping that appointment because you didn't make that appointment. And that appointment I'm talking about is the appointment of death. It's an appointment that every man will face. And nobody wants to face it. But every man will face it. We don't have a choice in the matter. And Monday I preached at another funeral at Rambali. And I was telling the people that the reason why that we have that appointment is because we have been stung with a poison. And that poison, the Bible calls it sin. If you want to be mad at somebody for Peter dying today, be mad at the devil and be mad at sin.
Yes.
Sin is the reason, the only reason why people die. That's the only reason. The Bible said to Adam in the beginning, don't do that, for the day you do it, you shall surely die. That was our foreparents, the first two human beings. They went and they involved in what God said, don't do, because you're going to die. And because of their involvement in that, they brought sin into humanity. And every man and woman who is born from the human race is born with that ability to die. Initially, when God created man, he did not make us with that. He made us pure. He made us after his image and likeness. He made us holy. He made us to exist forever. But he told them in the garden, do not eat of that. Do not involve yourself in that. For the day you do it, you shall die. And we saw that because of the influence of the wicked one, that they went and involved, and they brought death. They brought sin, and sin brought death. And because of that, everybody who's born out of the human race is subjected to this death. Sin that caused that. Sin caused that. And we continue to live our lives doing the very same thing that brought death. We sin all the time. Some of us do deliberately, some of us don't do deliberately, some of us we just don't care. But there's an appointment. Let me read a scripture for you. In the book of Ecclesiastes chapter, I'm going to read Ecclesiastes chapter 11. Verse 9. You know what the Bible says? It says, rejoice, O young man, in thy youth, and let your heart cheer you in the days of your youth, and walk in the ways of thine heart. So you say rejoice in your youth. Normally when we're young, we feel we're strong, we feel we have time, we have energy, we do what we want. So Ecclesiastes was written, which was written by the wisest one we ever lived, that was King Solomon. He was saying, rejoice, young man, in thy youth, and let your heart cheer thee in the days of your youth, and walk in the ways of your heart. So whatever you feel like doing, you want to do, go ahead. And in the sight of thine eyes, whatever your eyes like to see, you want to go behind, go ahead. But know thou, anything you see, anytime you see, but the whole concept is to bring something to your attention. There's a deviation there. So Paul, Solomon said, let your heart shed in your youth, go after what your heart desire, go after what your eyes could see. And he says, but, so he's doing a deviation. But know thou that for all these things, God will bring you into judgment.
Yes.
Friends of mine, if you read the scriptures, you'll understand, even our thoughts are being judged by God. That's what you do, you know, to your body. The thoughts you have that you never shed to nobody. Just in your heart, you know what? I don't like that person. God, in his eyes, God sees it. And the day is coming, he's going to judge it.
Yes.
So he said, rejoice in your youth. Go after the pleasure of your heart. Go after what you like to see. But know. That God will bring all of it into judgment. Let me read another scripture. Same Ecclesiastes chapter. This is Ecclesiastes chapter 12. Ecclesiastes chapter 12. We're going to read verse 14. It says, let's read verse 14. It says, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandment, for this is the whole duty of man. Verse 14 says, for God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, not just your work. He says, God shall bring your work into judgment and every secret thing. So even the things that we have done that nobody knows, the Bible is saying that God is going to bring it into judgment. Not now, but now. When your soul leaves your body. When our soul leaves our body, for some of us who don't know according to the scriptures, when our soul, which is our consciousness, when somebody dies, they are conscious they have died. They are conscious. You see you conscious you hear right now? When you die, you are conscious that your soul is leaving your body. And there's nothing you can do to bring that back. Absolutely nothing. You are conscious that you are leaving this realm. You are conscious. And you are going to another realm where you cannot return. But the realm where you are going into is that you are going to a realm where you're going to be facing God. See that God we read about and we hear about and we never see him? At death, your soul meets him. That is when, consciously, you meet with him. And everything you have done with your life comes to your consciousness and judges it rightly. So that's why the Bible says every secret thing, things that people never know, that you alone know that you did, God knows it and is going to bring it into judging. Amen. That's not just for you, that's for me to the preacher. And these are realities that we sometimes try to, we tend not to pay attention to. But I'm telling you, the day is coming that we will have to stand before a righteous and a holy God, and he will judge our intentions, our life, and all that we have done.
Amen.
What then should we do to prepare? Because that day is coming whether you like it or not. What then should we do to prepare? In the book of Acts chapter 17, I'm just bringing a few things to you, to reality for you. Things that you may not hear sometimes. You know, normally at funerals, at church maybe you're not here, but at a funeral you'll hear. A funeral is a good place for you to remember the reality of who you are. It always brings us back to when somebody lie down in a box, their education don't mean nothing. Their education don't mean nothing. Their money they have in the bank don't mean nothing. The car, the house, as you see Mr. Peter there, he have nothing with him. Absolutely nothing. It means nothing. When we reach there, it means nothing. We must live our life with the last day in mind. We must live our life like that. Acts chapter 17, and we're going to read verse 31. And then we're going to close. It says, And at the times of ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent.
Yes.
Why? He's commanding everybody to repent. Why? Because he have appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he have ordained, whereof he have given assurance unto all men that he have raised him from the dead. At the time of ignorance, when people did not know about God, God used to wink his eyes. But he says now, he commands every man to repent. What is repent? Repent is for you to acknowledge that you've been living wrong, and you've been living contrary to God all your life, and now you want to make it right with God. Hear me well. Repentance is not putting your clothes and going to church. A lot of us, when we go to church, we settle our debt with God. That's not true. Going to church does not settle your debt with God. Repentance is we coming to a place to realize that I want to have heard about God. I know I'm not living the way He wants me, and I want to make it right. How do I do that? There's one way to repentance. You acknowledge yourself before God, you acknowledge your wrong before Him, and you turn to His Son, Jesus Christ, so that you can receive forgiveness of sin. There's no difference between me and you. The only difference is that I have accepted Christ, that the sin that I have committed in my past and the sin I may ever commit will be washed away by His blood. So when my day comes to reach before God, when I reach there, His Son will say to His Father, "Father, I died for that one." Are you with me? I died for that one. You know why? Because when I was alive, I made a decision to repent and accept the Lord. Let me say in closing, there is no prayer me or anybody could say to change the fate of Isaac. You have nobody for you. There is no mass that will happen for you. There is no money you will give to no priest or no pastor for you to say no magical prayer to change your fate. Because the Bible says, what a man sow, that he shall reap. You ever plant a planting tree and get coconut underneath? If you plant a planting tree, you get plenty. If you plant coconut, you get coconut. What a man sow, that he will reap. Friends of mine, I want to encourage you today. Peter is gone. There's nothing you can do to change his fate. You, that are the land of the living, you could make it right. You could make it right with God by accepting His Son and receiving forgiveness of sin, of any type of sin. God not watching this. Any type of sin you've done, once you come to Him humbly in forgiveness, He forgives you. That's a promise He has made.
Amen.
Accept His Son, receive forgiveness of sin, so that when your day comes, you have nothing to worry about. Amen?
Amen.
You have nothing to worry about. So I pray that you be comforted today. And I pray that these words bless your heart. That will stop it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Praise God. Thank you, Pastor Stephen. I pray that the word that you have wounded, you will apply it in your life in Jesus' name. Quickly, the signing of the register, we have a friend at 2:30. I'm going to call those who are going to sign the queue to Pastor Lee. We have Christina Edwards, we have Shanna Edwards, we have Naya Andrews, we have Andy Isaac. Please make your way to sign the register, amen. Yes, we have got a note to make sure that we do it on time. So we have to be before the game. Praise God. So let us sign. Praise God. So why do you think that we're going to sing a good song, that song, How Great Thou Art, and then we're going to have a vote of thanks, and then we're going to pray. Amen? That's what we have to do. That's a verse we're going to sing.
Oh Lord my God, when
Shanto with a vote of thanks, and we're going to close in prayer. That'll be this place on time. Amen?
Amen.
We don't have to respect authority.
Yeah.
Praise God.
Good afternoon, everybody. What a ton of events today, I must say. You know, running around, getting caught because family members just won't come planning certain things. And you know, with the death of Peter, despite of, you know, what relationship me and him had, I would definitely say death and illnesses, it will definitely show you who your real friends and family are. If there's one thing I've learned over the years, you know, seeing Peter sick for about 10 years, thereabouts, is that blood doesn't make you family. Loyalty does. And I remember Peter being laid up, bedridden for years before he gave up his fight. So God decided, okay, Peter, this is enough. Christina Pompey asked him, you know? And I always wondered, maybe I go walk again, or maybe he'll eventually walk, or maybe, I mean, what's going on? I see people coming home sick for 2 days and boom, I'm hearing on the death announcement, that person died, that person. I'm like, Pete, Zakaria, I mean, you're not talking about two, but you know, but again, God makes no mistakes. Without any further ado, let me take this time out to extend our gratitude to everyone who supported Peter and his family in one way or the other. I want to say special thanks, especially to the Edward family. You know, my grandmother, Atufi, who laid by his side until his last days, being a caregiver in her old age and supported through thick and thin. Mom, Mary, do merci. Special thanks to the NICE team, who did visit off and on, made small contributions to him, which went a long way. I'll also extend, you know, gratitude to the pastors, deacons, and members of the Babylon Church of God, who did make a special effort to come visit him off and on whilst he was bedridden. You know, have little church services with him, praise with him, pray with him, sing with him. Just keep him comforted, let him remember that there is a God above, and that, you know, regardless of where you are, who you are, how you are, he does not sleep. He hears you, he feels you, and he makes no mistakes, like I said. Whether you're sick or not, he knows when you're ready, when he's ready for you, he's coming for you. And of course, we are taught to keep the faith. Again, thank you guys for, you know, conducting this funeral service. We are extremely thankful and we want to extend our gratitude to you guys. Also, special thanks to his friends and family who came by off and on just to visit, you know, to everyone who helped support him before and during his demise. Again, we extend our gratitude to everyone for all the support received, whether it was a call, just a visit, a contribution. None of it went unnoticed or unseen. And I mean, after the service, we do have some treats, you know, to provide to whoever is willing to accept as a way of saying thank you.
Amen.
Thank you, Senator. At this moment, let's kindly stand and we're closing prayer quickly. Pastor Lee, we close us in prayer. And then we're going to take our prayer and we'll find the rest complete.
Let's pray. Oh, Father in heaven, we give thanks to you for having had the opportunity to be here. These loved ones of Peter could come together to be farewell to him in a proper way. I pray, Father the Lord, that you keep them together in love and peace and unity. Amen. Above all, may we all examine our lives, examine ourselves, knowing that as long as life continues this way, one day we will find ourselves lying face up in a box like this. We will prepare ourselves for this time. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, I pray that you dismiss us with your blessings. Amen. Amen. Amen.
So Alison, we're going to take you to his final person place at the Shock Cemetery. Amen.
Amen.
give me Jesus. In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, oh, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Oh, give me Jesus. You can't have all this world. Give me Jesus. When I am alone, oh, when I am alone, when I am alone, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, oh, give me Jesus. All I need, oh, it's all I need.
Give me
Jesus. Oh,
give me Jesus.
In the morning when I rise, when I lay.
Jesus.
I need. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We worship you. We worship you. Say we worship you, Lord. You're the answer to my prayers. You're the calm in the storm. You're my rest and my refuge.
Didn't know today would be our last, or that I'd have to say goodbye to you so fast. I'm so numb I can't feel anymore. I'm praying you'd just walk back through that door and tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone as long as I believe. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Always made my troubles feel so small, and you were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world where heroes come and go, well, God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight, singing hallelujah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. If you give a little more than you take, and if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who takes the time to help a stranger in the rain, there's a place for people like you. If you stand up for those down on their knees and lend a voice to those who cannot speak, if you shine a little light, give sight to the ones who've lost their way, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold. When your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you. If you walk around with your heart on your sleeve, and if you're trying to be the change you wanna see, if you lay down your life for love so someone could be saved, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold. Days down here or through, there's a place up there for people like you.
child before life removed all the innocence. My father would lift me high and dance with my mother and me, and then spin me around till I fell asleep. Then up the stairs he would carry me, and I knew for sure I was loved. If I could get another chance, another walk, another dance with him, I'd play a song that would never ever end. How I'd love, love, to dance with my father again. Ooh. When I and my mother would disagree, to get my way I would run from her to him. He'd make me laugh just to comfort me, yeah, yeah. Then finally make me do just what my mama said. Later that night when I was asleep, he left a dollar under my sheet. Never dreamed that he would be gone from me. Final glance, one final step, one final dance with him. I'd play a song that would never ever end, 'cause I'd love, love, love to dance with my father again. Sometimes I'd listen outside her door, and I'd hear how my mother cried for him. I pray for her even more than me. I pray for her even more than me. I know I'm praying for much too much, but could you send back the only man she loved? I know you don't do it usually, but dear Lord, she's dying to dance with my father again. Every night I fall asleep, and this is all I ever dream.
Sit a while with me.
You raise me up so I can't stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be.
Because man sin, God tell them, because you sin, You came from the ground, you're going to go back there. Because from dust you are, and the dust you shall return. The lesson is that when we think we are something, we are nothing.
Oh, yeah.
Because we came from the ground. It's only because God's presence dwells in us, gives us value. And when God's presence leaves our body, then we are nothing. So let us live our lives knowing that it is only God that gives us value. And today, we're going to recommit Brother Isaac's body back to the ground. Because from dust he came, and from dust he shall return.
It's a troubles come and my heart burden be, and I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be.